I will not be living here, then.
Your father is eager to have you live with him.
Is it a long journey, Uncle?
No.
Catherine, my love.
He's gone, Nelly. My cousin is gone.
How am I to love my father if I don't know him?
All children love their parents.
Is Wuthering Heights as pleasant a place as Thrushcross Grange?
It is not so buried in trees, and it is not quite so large, but you can see the country beautifully all round. I'm quiet now. No more questions. You are already looking so pale.
Ah, you brought it, have you? I feared I'd have to come down and fetch my property myself.
One footstep on my land, and you know what will happen to you.
Well, let's see what we can make of it. Oh, God, what a beauty.
Well, damn my soul, it is worse than I expected, and the devil knows I wasn't very hopeful.
Looks worse than you.
Do you know me?
No.
Well, your mother was a wicked slut to keep you in ignorance, the sort of father you possess.
How dare you? I shall carry him.
What about you? I've had the strength
to carry your soul.
Don't leave me. Don't stay here. Don't leave me, Uncle Edgar.
You must be kind to your son, else as God is my witness, I shall find a way of hurting you.
I shall be very kind to him. You needn't fear.
Stay just one night, just long enough for me to get to know him better.
Because I do not think that is what his father would wish for him, Catherine.
Is he far away?
Exceeding far.
Your father travelled all night.
When Linton's mother died, I wanted nothing more than to have him here with us, but that is simply not possible. We will have to remain as we have always been, just you and me, the two of us, and Nelly here.
All I wanted was a friend. But you took him away and you will not tell me why, so it is not like it always was. It can never be like that anymore.
It was Kathy's, your mother's. I've kept it these 18 years.
My father is up at the church, I suppose. Why does his sadness at mother's death always weigh on his happiness that I was born?
Now, Jake. What shall we do to cheer you up?
I know where I wish to go, where a colony of Morgame is settled.
That must be a good distance up, I'm not so sure.
Please, Nelly. You did ask me, and it is my birthday.
All right, but we must be back within the hour.
Where are they, Miss Catherine? We must go back.
A little further, only a little further, Ellen.
We must go back. We really must go back.
What are you doing, girl?
I was searching for grouse eggs.
My land? That would be poaching.
Papa said there were quantities on the moor, and I would never have taken any. I just wished to see them.
And Papa is Mr. Linton of Thrushcross Grange, is he not?
Who are you?
You don't know me.
Of course I don't.
Yet I know you. Catherine.
You may know my name, but you don't know me.
I know enough to know that today is your birthday. I was acquainted with your mother. I know that today is the anniversary of her death.
Oh, I see. And you saw me and recognized my mother in me.
No. There is nothing of your mother in you.
Well, how then?
Come and meet my son. You know him already. He will help explain everything.
Know him? How could I?
Come to my house and see, child.
I will come. But I think you are mistaken. Catherine! Catherine, no! No, half a minute!
Who is that? Didn't I tell you you knew him?
Linton? Is that you? This is your son.
Catherine, I prayed so to see you before I died.
You were so close these past months. Why did you never come and see me?
Best ask your father, that.
My father? He told me that Linton was living many miles away. So you must be my uncle, then.
If you have any kisses, child, give them to Linton.
We should go, young lady. You should not have come here.
Why? Because I would discover that my cousin should be so close.
Make yourself at home, Nellie. Your old chair still sits there for you.
You lived here, too?
She did, indeed. And she raised your mother here.
Is this true, Nellie?
And she raised me also, although I don't know if Nellie looks at me with pride for the job she did. Now, son, have you nothing you can go and show your cousin? Take her to the stables to see the horses.
Wouldn't you rather sit here?
I love being out of doors, don't you?
Hareton, come here. You shall have to settle for Hareton here. Isn't he a handsome lad? Go with her around the farm and behave like a gentleman, mind, and don't stare. There. Now you have a challenger for your cousin's heart.
It's some damnable writing, but I cannot read.
Perhaps I could help you to read, if your master would allow it.
My master? My master? Damn you! I'll see thee damned before they calls me servant.
I'm sorry if I gave offence.
He's not a servant. He's your cousin too.
My cousin?
I have tied his tongue. He will never be able to emerge from his coarseness and ignorance.
And is this how you take your revenge? By warping the next generation? Is that why you lured young Catherine here?
I just want her and Linton to get to know each other. Where's the harm of it?
From now on, you are to avoid his house and his family.
I know this is because you dislike Mr. Heathcliff.
No, it is because he dislikes me and is a most diabolical man, delighting to wrong and ruin those he hates if they give him the slightest opportunity.
But Mr. Heathcliff was quite cordial, Father.
And he didn't object to our seeing each other.
He detests you on my account. I am certain of that. You will listen to me and you will obey me. You will not visit Wuthering Heights.
You must rest, sir.
I cannot abandon her to him. I cannot.
Catherine, no, you don't know my father. Please, I beg you.
Let me guess which is your room.
Catherine, will you please desist in this? Strike anyone who so much as touches it.
This is my mother, isn't it?
Yes.
This is my mother's room.
Yes.
Why would Mr. Heathcliff keep a portrait of my mother? Why? Why would he do that?
Because he loved her. Because he loved her before your father did. And she loved him.
What? Why do you say such things?
My father says it is true.
You liar! You liar! It's locked! Where did your father keep the key?
I am 18 years old and I am dying.
For pity's sake, Linton.
And that is why father wants us to be married as soon as we can.
What?
He made me change my will and bequeath everything to him. He wants us to be married. He wanted me to lure you here, and I tried not to act the traitor, but you would not leave. You would not leave. All the doors have been locked, Catherine.
Help! Help!
If you want to see your father before he dies, you must obey Heathcliff. You must.
You think I would ever love you before my father?
Well, I take it from this touching scene that you have made your offer of marriage and young Miss Linton is expressing some misgivings.
Give me that key. I would not marry him if you keep me here forever.
By this time tomorrow, I shall be your father, so you had better get used to appeasing me. Thank you.
father? He is gravely ill, my lord. He may not last the night.
Please take me home.
I found him on the streets of Liverpool, where he would have died with his mother. He will not tell me his name, so I'm going to name him myself. Kathy. Hindley. This is Heathcliff.
Gypsy brat like you into the house. Is it hardness or gentleness that stops you from complaining?
Judge, there's been understair work there.
Mr. Earnshaw has shown great charity, and that's all there is to this.
Now then, young man, have you been baptised?
He's not much of a one for conversation.
Well, you know how I feel about baptisms, Mr. Earnshaw. And as he's a bastard, his soul is in greater peril.
Heathcliff, why don't you go off and join the others, eh? Child in the gutter, and I shall raise him up to be a fine, upstanding gentleman.
Good to see you know your place, gypsy boy. Said, glad to see you know your place.
Oh, cuckoo in the nest, cuckoo in the nest.
Don't look your betters in the eye.
No, Hindley! Hindley, stop! Stop it, I say!
He needs to be shown his place, Kathy. Else he'll kill us all in our beds. Go on, Harold! Here it is! Teach the bastard a lesson!
Yourselves. Hey!
I will ask once more before I order Joseph to flog the both of you. What was the cause of the fight? Joseph.
The other boy said that Heathcliff was your bastard. He said that you kept a whore in Liverpool when Mother was dying. And Heathcliff said you could say what you liked about him, but not blacken your name.
Thank you, Kathy. You and Heathcliff may go. Who was it who told this boy from the village these wicked things, do you suppose? You do agree that they are wicked things to say.
The boy was only repeating what the whole village is saying.
Is no man allowed to act charitably in this world without even his own son ascribing the basest motives for his actions?
We cannot attend church without fingers pointing and tongues wagging.
Fine. Fine. Then we will no longer go to church. You will be going away to school soon, Hindi, so this need not concern you.
Well, I say, who is this handsome young squire?
Goodbye, Nelly.
Now, you be sure to come back from school a gentleman.
Goodbye, son.
Watch him, Kathy. Watch Heathcliff very closely. He's a cuckoo in a nest. Feeds on father's affections until father won't have anything left to give you.
I'll think this horse would suit you well. Eh? I bought a fine silver locket for Kathy. So, it's only fair.
Thank you, Father. It's beautiful.
Now, come on, Heathcliff, would you like him?
Sophia Thoroughbred, this one. 16 hands high.
He does look fine. Not think, Heathcliff.
The deal, then?
There's no rush, is there?
Oh, we've got a right little trader here, have we?
Let him run in the field.
What's that?
I said let him run in the field.
Now, let's not be silly.
You do as he says if you want to sail. Come on, lad.
Come on.
That's your thoroughbred.
He's a sharp young man, is he not?
Sharp as a razor. I didn't know better until he had a touch of gypsy in him.
You can ride it, race it, jump it, hunt it. Oh, I wish I were younger that I could enjoy it myself.
She's yours. Where do you suppose I'm from? Where do you suppose I began?
You began in here. I dreamed you up. Heathcliff, don't fret so.
That horse trade with the fair sensed my wretched beginnings. It's like a badge I will always have to wear.
Your beginnings might have been more noble than any of us. Look at you. You fit for a prince in disguise.
Try not to look so surly.
He hates me, I hate him. No end of smiling will change that.
Mr. English, sir.
My dear?
You must be Kathy. Oh, I've longed to meet you. I shall be quite the big sister to you.
Kathy? Now, perhaps...
Cathy, you could show my wife around our house so she can choose which room suits her best.
I was hoping that we could have adjoining rooms, sister.
Don't just stand there gawping, Heathcliff. Go and see to the horses. From henceforth, you and Joseph will quarter yourselves in the back kitchen. I want my wife to have free run of the house, and I don't want her to be falling over servants all day.
Of course.
No matter to me where I am, as long as I have the good book to guide me.
Oh, good. I was wondering where you were skulking off to.
Was there any way to address your brother?
From now on, you will keep company only with the servants. You will earn your keep by labouring out of doors.
If you're sure that's what Father would have wished.
And you will never speak to me or the mistress unless spoken to first. Is that clear?
How can you smile?
Because one day I shall pay back Hindley with pain and anguish.
Is it not for God to punish wicked people?
No. She shan't have the satisfaction that I shall. I don't care how long I have to wait. I just hope he doesn't die before me.
Don't talk in such a way, my love.
And when I think of revenge, I don't feel pain. Would you rather I felt pain? God.
Heathcliff.
I'm not just weeping for our father. I'm weeping for what will become of us. We've lost our protector. How can we ever be together again?
I don't want that I was in heaven.
I don't want to hearken to your dreams.
And heaven didn't seem to be my home. And I broke my heart with weeping to come back to earth. And the angels, they were so angry with me that they flung me out into the middle of the heath on top of Wuthering Heights. And I woke sobbing for joy because you were here. We cannot escape each other.
Let's run away.
When?
Now.
Tomorrow. Gives us a day to get what little I've saved.
Fuck me.
I saw you! I saw the pair of you!
Cathy, if we get caught, they'll hang us.
Do you remember how we used to come here and taunt the Lintons?
dances like a badly trained monkey.
Who's there? Who's there?
Come on, let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
He won't come out of here. He hasn't the art for it.
Fiend. You should go to the gallows for this.
She's hurt, you fool. She needs help.
Hold your tongue.
The rascals knew yesterday was Father's rent day, no doubt. There's been no stopping these people's insolence.
It'd be a kindness to hang him before he does more damage.
Miss Earnshaw. Of course it's Miss Earnshaw. You are hurt.
Are you sure, brother? Miss Earnshaw running around the country with that frightful thing.
I shall carry her home if I have to, Cathy.
She's too weak to do anything. I will take her inside. Kindly go and tell your master, Mr. Hindley, we will send her back when she is fully recovered.
Take one more step and I shall take great pleasure in putting you down.
Please,
sister, you shall nurse Miss Earnshaw until the doctor arrives. I will ride into Gibberton immediately.
And did they say how long they're intending on keeping her?
They wouldn't tell me.
I see. I see.
I thought I'd be due a flogging.
Oh, far from it. Get out, then. Owen Heathcliff. If you speak one word to Cathy while she is staying with the Lintons, or try to contact her in any way, you will be dismissed. Instantly.
Keep our patient behind doors for 5 weeks.
Dr. Kenneth doesn't think you... He'll be running about on the moors for a little while yet.
I can go on horseback.
Well, I'm not sure that's advisable, not from what he was saying.
I shall die of boredom.
Well, Isabella and I were thinking that since you are forbidden from moving, that perhaps she could paint your portrait while you sit. Then we could think up no end of distractions.
No end of distractions. How lovely.
You know, if you choose to accept our kindness, that doesn't mean you're betraying your own nature or that of your friend. And you have had a terrible shock and you've lost a lot of blood and... I know your father died recently. So all in all, you seem like a young lady who might not have had a lot of care in her life of late. So as... stiff and as pompous as Isabella and I might seem compared with... If you would just let us look after you, would that really be such a bad thing?
Lintons will blame you, of course, for her heathen upbringing and her wild ways.
I'm sure they will. And I'm sure the brother will pay me a visit to lecture me on my brotherly carelessness.
So why are you looking so pleased with yourself?
Because the longer she is there, the more likely she will come under some civilizing influence. Ah, my dear. We may even be able to recover our family's good name.
I think it's from Paris, actually.
Is that a bird?
Is it a bird?
A bird?
Yes, it is. It's a blue tit. Do you know the tit family?
It's white. It can't be a blue tit.
Well, I think it's the winter plumage. I shoot these birds.
Here, I should scarcely have known you. Where is the wild little savage from 5 weeks ago?
Oh, don't touch them, my lord.
Come, boys, come. Come, boys.
While you're doing this. Kathy. You're quite the young lady. Heathcliff not here.
Heathcliff, you may come forward. You may greet Miss Cathy like the other servants.
Oh. Well, Heathcliff, have you forgotten me? Is that why you scowl at me?
I've not forgotten someone who looked like you. Someone you no longer seem to be.
Do not tease me, my lord.
Shake hands, Heathcliff. Once in a way that is permitted. Perhaps you may learn from Cathy's example.
Not standing to be left at.
Why are you refusing to see me?
Because I don't know you. Hindley is right. That little savage is lost, and it was her that I loved.
I know you. And I love you.
In the way a mistress loves a servant.
No.
Come away with me, then. As we planned. There. The pause that betrays you.
I'm frightened.
Of what? Of me? Or poverty?
You're asking me to risk my reputation. Once a woman's reputation is gone, she has nothing.
The old Cathy would never have said such a thing.
The old Cathy didn't know the world and how it regarded us.
I have tried to leave you. But your love holds me here. Now, if you mean to be indifferent to me, at least do me the favor of releasing me.
I'm as trapped as you are.
Except your cage is more gilded than mine.
Why don't you dress up smart before Cathy's guests arrive? Master says that everyone is welcome.
I do not think that Cathy will welcome me.
If I tell you that she cries whenever I tell her that you're not here...
I would say I have more reason to cry than her.
If you try to mend your appearance, then Edgar Linton shall look quite a doll beside you.
And how will I have the chance of ever being as rich as he?
You think yourself rather handsome. I kept some of Mr. Earnshaw's best suits when he died. I think they'd be a good fit on you. You wash yourself and I shall lay one out on your bed. And when you come back, see if you don't make all the ladies swoon.
There now, Hindley. Did I not tell you my dress would look wonderful on Cathy?
You are making me very proud, Cathy. Very proud indeed.
I think I can hear them arriving.
Try not to run.
Oh, darling. She's a spirited girl, and it would be a shame to tame her completely.
Now remember, Heathcliff, show an amiable humour.
Don't do that. You could come.
Not as
Mr. Anders the Grange, of course, but please.
It's charming.
No, I'm not your servant.
To the stable, you vagabond.
I am not your servant. Don't stare at me as though I'm not.
Combing your pretty curls, have you?
Please, Hindley.
Your dirty gypsy locks, you fiend. I will break your insolence. I will break you.
Stop. Break you, fiend.
All right, young man. What have you got to say for yourself?
Your own father brought me home because he wanted a son that he could love. All the flogging in the world won't change that.
Where is my wife?
She took herself to bed. She felt suddenly out of sorts.
Well, that brute of a servant warmed me nicely. Next time, Edgar, take the law into your own fists. We'll give you an appetite. Come now, eat up. That gypsy won't be offending us again. Joseph is locked in the stable for the night.
You have a son. You have a lovely son.
Henshaw, it's a blessing your wife was spared long enough to give you this son.
She's not dead. Damn you. Damn you all, not believe it.
You know better than to choose such a sickly lass.
How dare you! Get out of my house. Get out! Do not bring him near me, Nelly. Not unless you want to see me dash his brains out.
Smile, my love.
If I tell you why I'm smiling, I think you'll smile too.
Tell me.
As Hindley was flogging me, I chanted a curse and love. He's lost the only person that ever loved him.
You cannot welcome the death of a baby's mother.
I welcome anything that makes Hindley suffer.
So you're sorry for talking like this, my love?
I'm not sorry.
Sometimes think your true passion is hate rather than love. Hindley?
Thank you.
would turn every gentleman's head in Yorkshire. Heathcliff.
Going somewhere?
Where would I go, my love? It's raining.
Here you have that silk frock on, my love. Someone coming here, perhaps?
Perhaps.
Eglinton.
That's enough, Nellie. Let me alone.
Three months ago, we lay together, yet since then, every evening is spent with the Lintons.
Perhaps I find Edgar easier company. Perhaps he doesn't talk of curses and fall into a brooding silence.
So you dislike my company?
It's no company at all when people know nothing and say nothing.
Yeah. There, at last you've said it, I'm no longer worthy of you. This will make you suffer for this.
So I'm cursed too, am I?
No, I'm the one that is truly cursed. I was cursed the moment I laid eyes on you. How does Hindley do?
He drinks.
And the little one, his baby? How is Hareton? I'm not come too soon, am I?
No. What are you doing there, Nellie?
My work, miss.
Take yourself and your dusters off. Leave the room, Nellie.
Kathy, love, Kathy.
Fidgeting in my presence. You must not go.
I must. I feel you do not want me here.
Eglinton, sit down. You shall not leave me in that temper. I shall be miserable all night. I believe you are far too kind to wish me miserable for you. If that's you, Nellie, then I'm sorry for scolding you. I wish now that you'd stayed.
It's not Nellie, it is I. Why, Kathy, what is it? What's the matter?
Edgar Linton's asked me to marry him.
And have you given him your answer? But you did not say no. And have you considered how you will bear separation from me and how I will be quite deserted in the world without you? Did you consider that?
Are you quite deserted? We separated. Who is to separate us, pray?
You will be Mrs. Linton.
Yes. And as Mrs. Linton, I can aid you to rise and place you out of my brother's power.
With your husband's money, you will rescue me. Do you think I could endure such a thing? Not you will be Mrs. Linton.
Do you love Mr. Edgar?
Of course I do.
Why do you love him?
I do. Isn't that sufficient?
By no means. You must say why.
Well, because he's handsome and pleasant to be with.
It's bad.
I shall be rich. I'll be the greatest woman in the neighborhood.
Stand still. However, I suppose your brother will be pleased. Edgar Linton is a good man and he will save you. Tis neither practical nor desirable for you to marry Heathcliff. And if you love Edgar, and Edgar loves you, where is the obstacle?
Nellie, my love for Edgar is like the foliage in the woods. Time will change it, I'm well aware.
My love for Heathcliff resembles the eternal rocks beneath. My great miseries in this world have been Heathcliff's miseries. If all else perished and he remained, I should still continue to be. Nelly, I am Heathcliff. Not as a pleasure, but as my own being. I cannot think of our separation. I will never talk of our separation again.
You are about to take are to be made in the presence of God, who is judge of all and knows all the secrets of our hearts.
I think there is a small patch of heather left near Penistone Crags.
How I love them.
And how I love you.
Kiss me, Hatton. Damn thee, kiss me! Unnatural cow, come hither! You come hither!
Hindley. Boy, he's tired, so are you. Why don't you go and rest somewhere?
As you wish, sister mine. As you wish.
That was gently done, Kathy.
Perhaps marriage agrees with me.
Are you happy?
Dear Nellie, I have such faith in Edgar's love. I believe I might kill him and he wouldn't wish to retaliate. Of course we shall. Perhaps next time we're having a wedding breakfast, it will be yours. What do you think you're doing?
I need you to take this and promise me you won't tell your husband how to throttle me.
Who will?
He did not give a name.
Gave you this note, did he say anything else?
No. He just told me to promise you won't tell your husband.
Where did you meet him? Where?
All right.
My darling. Who was that? You're trembling.
Just a boy spying on the celebrations. It reminded me of when I first looked in on you.
Of course. And you were with that gypsy who ran away.
Heathcliff.
That's right. Heathcliff.
That a jack straight away. That's 3 points to me.
I beg.
Begs. That's three for you. What are the chances of another jack turning up like that, Mr. Inlay?
I would say the chances are very high indeed. If the man dealing the cards is a cheating blackguard of the lowest order.
I don't know you, sir. But as you are a gentleman, I'll let you apologize for that remark and leave this place unscathed.
I may be a gentleman now, but I've just spent the last 3 years in the company of men lower than you.
I know you. But I know you.
I defy you to repeat that allegation, sir.
And I defy you to speak to your new landlord in such a way.
Landlord? That's not right, sir.
Do you not live in Penistone cottages like all the other mill workers? But I bought the lease of those cottages only this morning. And I must warn you, I do not relent in exacting my due from anyone.
I was just taking advantage of the fact that Mr. Inlay were taking a drink, sir.
Keep it. You may lie to Mr. Inlay till he goes to hell, but you do not lie to me. Do you understand? So, my cards, are they not? Did you ever play Trinidad or Four, sir? Well, there is a game for cutthroats. London.
I'm afraid today the celebrations. I'm a little feverish.
Of course. Inconsiderate of me, You sleep here, I will have Nelly make up a bed in my old room.
Thank you. You are very kind, husband.
Give her the note like you said,
sir. Good man. Now, how much did you start with tonight, sir?
3 shillings, sir.
Well, there's six. And as for you, lad, the rest is for you.
What's it?
£8, take it. Come with me. I shall see you safe home with such a fortune. Take his coat. He has a trap and two outside, gentlemen.
So, the devil sent thee back to us, has he?
Still alive, Joseph.
Aye. Still strong and all.
Perhaps God is keeping you on earth because he would find your company so irksome in heaven.
Your blasphemy don't touch me. It's your soul you're damning.
My soul is already damned, Joseph. You can count on that. You do not know me, Nelly. Look! I'm not a stranger.
Is it really you, is it?
Yes. Heathcliff.
Are they at home? Where is she? Is she here? Speak. Speak.
Yes, Nellie? What is it?
A person from Gimmerton wishes to see you, ma'am.
When I heard you know, I thought I'd never see you again.
Why didn't you believe that I would return?
Oh, no, angry, my love. I don't know. Oh, please, Cliff. Oh, I shall think it a dream tomorrow. And I'll be able to believe that I've seen and touched and spoken to you once more.
When can we be alone? When?
The master would like you to bring your guest in, madam. He thinks it unseemly for you to be standing out here with a gentleman.
Edgar! Edgar! Heathcliff's come back!
Well, don't strangle me for that.
Oh, no, you didn't like him yet. For my sake, you must be friends now!
Cathy, try to be glad without being absurd. The whole household need not witness the sight of your welcoming a runaway servant as a brother.
Look, who I discovered in the hall. Has Mr. Heathcliff not changed beyond all recognition, Edgar?
Not entirely, no. Sit down, sir. Mrs. Linton, recalling old times, would have me give you a cordial reception, and of course I am gratified when anything occurs to please my wife.
Your wife? Oh, yes. I heard you married only yesterday.
A pity you did not come sooner, Mr. Heathcliff. You could have made merry at the celebrations.
I am not much of a one for making merry, Miss Isabella.
Too busy making your fortune, no doubt.
And what would make you think that I have made a fortune?
I can see by your bearing and your dress that you've not spent your time away from us trading horses and reading fortunes, as some might think.
That much is true.
So are we to learn how you have made your money, Mr. Heathcliff?
The same way as any man, by taking advantage of other men's weaknesses.
You must forgive Heathcliff, Mr. Linton. He always liked to provoke.
Cathy, unless we are to have cold tea, I am thirsty, and Mr. Heathcliff will have a long walk wherever he may lodge tonight.
Not so far, really. I'm staying at the Heights. Hindley invited me this morning when I called.
Hindley invited you, really?
Yes, as a call to inquire about Miss Earnshaw. I'm sorry, I mean, Mrs. Linton.
Have you no fear of the consequences of fixing your dwelling with your ancient persecutor?
I think my strong head will keep me from danger. And your brother can hardly be made morally worse than he already is now, can he? I always imagined that you might end up marrying Hindley, Miss Isabella.
Me? Oh, I think not. Not nearly handsome enough.
Well, as I'm sure Cathy will tell you, the female heart can feel a sudden and irresistible attraction towards the most unlikely of men. Wouldn't you agree? Edgar.
I know what my own heart tells me, and that is all any man needs to know, as far as I can tell.
Well, it seems we have all grown wiser in the years of my absence.
Indeed, sir. I hope that is true.
Thank you.
how's married life been treating you in this past month?
Where is he?
Out on the moors. Inspecting some land I have for sale. He imagines he outflanks me.
He will destroy you.
He pays me good rent.
For living here?
For sleeping in your old room.
Why did you not come sooner? I've waited weeks to see you.
A married woman. Every movement is monitored and remarked upon.
You've made yourself a pretty prison, have you not, by being too impatient to marry?
He gave me not a word. In 3 years, not one indication whether you were alive or dead.
When I heard that you were to marry, I had one thought in my head I would return. Have one glimpse of your face. Settle my score with Hindley, then prevent the law by executing myself. Now I see I should have stuck to my course.
And you when I was to marry and you didn't return to stop me from taking such a step.
You'd already betrayed me with your heart.
So you returned on my wedding day to punish me.
There's a look in your eyes. My God, I think it's guilt. You've been with him, haven't you? You've laid with Edgar, haven't you?
He's my husband.
You think your pretend marriage matters to me? How am I to look at you? How am I to touch you on his milky, feeble hands of elder as I'm holding you now? You disgust me.
I'm sorry. What have I done?
How about a game of threes up? You call it, you win it all back. Every penny.
What if I should call wrong?
I'd take you to the yard, strip you of your shirt, and flog you. Just as you flogged me.
Mr. Heathcliff, I think it's nearly daylight out there. We'd probably best be going, eh?
Well, now, so, I bring you Hindley night in, night out. Pumped with cash, ripe for the plucking. I think it's only good manners that you stay until Hindley's fate is decided. What do you say, Hindley? My cash against the skin on your back
and my blood. Why not? Why not?
Call it.
Tails.
Behind the stable door, you will find a whip. Oil each tail so they do not snag in his open wounds.
I think perhaps you've humiliated him enough, Mr. Heathcliff.
I cannot feel any satisfaction for the humiliation I have heaped upon him so far. And the more revenge I get, the greater my appetite for it.
The lad, sir. Think about Hareton.
You were a good man, so. A good man. I could have been a good man once, but then I met Hindley. One day, I must sit you down. You can tell me how to be good.
Gentlemen, thank you for diverting evening. See yourselves out.
Well, my love?
Just a little tired. Perhaps now the weather grows finer, we'll see some more of Mr. Heathcliff. I think Mr. Heathcliff has satisfied his curiosity, and from now on we shall see very little of him. That is a shame.
Why so?
Because I liked him. And I desired his company.
Surely you do not covet the admiration of Heathcliff. I hope I've misunderstood you, Isabella.
You have not misunderstood me.
You cannot consider him an agreeable person.
You are a dog in the manger, Cathy, and desire no one to be loved but yourself.
That is enough. You shall not talk to my wife like that again, Isabella, and you shall apologize.
I'm sorry, sister.
You would come in the end.
Is Miss Isabella at home?
Miss Isabella?
Is she home?
Now come. I like her too well to let you absolutely seize and devour her up. Besides, I would not approve.
You would not approve? You who have treated me infernally, infernally, do you hear? And if you flatter yourself that I don't perceive it, you are a fool.
Darling, don't speak like this.
And if you think I can be consoled by sweet words, you are an idiot. So I will ask you again. Is Miss Isabella at home?
Heathcliff, I am proud to show you at last somebody who dotes on you more than myself.
Sister, dear, I really...
I'm sure that my poor little sister-in-law is breaking her heart by mere contemplation of your physical and moral beauty.
Cathy, this is most unfair. Be kind enough to excuse me. Cathy forgets that you and I are not intimate acquaintances. And what amuses her is painful to me beyond expression.
You had no reason to treat the poor girl in such a manner.
Do not fret. I would as soon as put a canary in the park on a winter's day than recommend she bestow a heart on you.
There would be a certain symmetry, though, would there not, in Miss Isabella Hinton and I becoming lovers?
Perhaps your fortune has changed you.
Well, my fortune has changed me in every regard. Except one. And if I could change that too, I would do so.
I'm Laura Linney, and this is Masterpiece Classic. Previously...
By this time tomorrow, I shall be your father, so you had better get used to appeasing me.
Can it be true, Nellie, that my mother loved this monster?
They were childhood sweethearts. Nothing more.
From now on, you will keep company only with the servants.
Eglinton's asked me to marry him.
I need you to take this and promise me you won't tell your husband also throttle me.
In 3 years, not one indication whether you were alive or dead. What have I done?
Emily Bronte's Wuthering Heights, tonight on Masterpiece Classic. Masterpiece is made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. Emily Bronte was a clergyman's daughter. She grew up in a remote part of England. She didn't like to travel. When she left home, she became ill. She never married and died at the age of 30, having published one novel under a pseudonym. It was one of the most shocking novels in English literature. When it was first published in 1847, it created a firestorm of protest. It was called one of the most repellent books ever published. One critic said it should be burned. The storm of protest only got louder when the second edition came out and the author was revealed to be the daughter of a parson from West Yorkshire. How had a parson's daughter created such a threat to civilized society as Heathcliff, an anti-hero driven by sexual passion and vengeance? And instead of a proper Victorian heroine, she gave the world a married woman who runs around on the moors in her nightgown having trysts with her lover. The reading public was shocked. Shocked. And the novel has never been out of print. Wuthering Heights.
What is this?
This is an agreement that Mr. Heathcliff has the first option to purchase any more land and buildings you may wish to sell. This is the balance of the account, sir.
Joseph! Saddle up Hunter!
Had I known I could ruin that man in the space of 3 months, I would come back soon.
I thought I would never find this place.
That's why I told you to bring Cathy's horse. She could find her way up here in the dark.
Is this the place you bring all your sweethearts?
Only Cathy before you.
Is that how it's always going to be? Cathy before me.
I saw a spirit in you last time I saw you at the Grange, Isabella, that stayed with me. It is as though your brother has a woman's gentleness and you have all the fight.
Cannot tell whether you are flattering me or not.
Anything you hear about me is bad. But you see some good in me. That's why would you be here?
Perhaps I'm attracted to the bad in you.
No, do not make a joke of it. A person who sees the good in me is a sensation I experience so rarely that it is enough to make me want to at least try to love you.
What are you about raising this stir? I said you must let Isabella alone, I beg you! I'd have been received here, and you wish Edgar to draw the bolts against you.
God forbid he should try. God keep him meek and patient.
I love Heathcliff more than you have ever loved Edgar, and he might love me if you would let him.
I know he could never love a Linton, and yet he's quite capable of marrying you to hurt me. He's as good as told me.
I don't believe you.
What is it to you? I have a right to kiss her. If she chooses, and you have no right to object. I am not your husband. There's no need for you to be jealous.
If you like Isabella, you shall marry her. But do you like her, Heathcliff? Tell the truth. Answer me. Answer me! You will not leave here until you answer me!
Imagine if you wished me to marry Isabella, I'd come right through to
it. Take her. pleases you. You clearly prefer the bliss of inflicting misery to the bliss of our love.
This is insufferable. It is disgraceful that you should own him for a friend and force his company on me.
Is that how you call it, sir?
I have so far been forbearing with you, sir. Your presence is a moral poison that would contaminate the most virtuous. For that cause and to prevent worse consequences, I shall deny you hereafter admission into this house.
Kathy, this lamb of yours threatens like a bull. It's in danger of splitting its skull against my knuckles.
I require your instant departure, sir. 1 minute's delay will render it involuntary and ignominious.
No, I will not move until I hear an apology from you.
An apology?
After constant indulgence of both men, I earn for thanks 2 samples of blind ingratitude. Edgar, I was defending you and yours.
Kathy, please get out of my way.
Apologize.
Get out of my way!
Make an apology or allow yourself to be beaten.
All I want is your happiness. But I must admit, utterly defeated in this. Indeed, I can only attribute your spite and venom and betrayal to some unfathomable damage deep inside your heart. To think anything else is to think so badly of you that I cannot bear it.
Well, I must compliment you on your taste, Kathy. This is the slavering thing that you would prefer to me.
Remain where you are, Kathy. I shall not stay, but I wish just to learn whether, after this day's events, you intend to continue your intimacy.
For mercy's sake, just let us hear no more of it.
Get rid of me. Answer my question. Will you give up Heathcliff hereafter, or will you give up me? It is impossible to be my friend and his at the same time, and I absolutely require to know which you choose.
You cannot make me choose.
I demand it.
If I choose to remain friends with him,
then I shall ask you to leave this house.
May I speak?
To chastise me for my weakness, to mock me for my kindness.
If you hear me out and you still want me to leave, then I shall relinquish any claim I have on you.
Very well.
If you cast me out, you shall cast out both your wife and your child. I am with child, Edgar. I came to you.
So I see. Though after your brother's threats and entreaties, I had rather you didn't. He has, after all, threatened my life.
Kathy is with child.
You are lying. Has Edgar put you up to this?
Sir, any loyalty I feel in this is entirely to you. That is why I've come here, to tell you this. Even though he warned me that if I was insane enough to encourage what he calls my worthless suitor, he will dissolve all bonds of relationship between him and me. Yet, as you see, I am here.
Thank you.
Feed and water the horses, then bed them down. My bride and I shall be staying here for the night.
Could you? My fastenings.
Isabella is gone. She's run off with Mr. Heathcliff.
This is not true. It cannot be.
The lad who fetches the milk told me they were spotted 2 miles out of Gimmerton. And I've checked her room and her bed is not slept in, so they have a day's start. How will you catch up with them?
She went of her own accord. She had a right to go if she pleased.
No, Master, she is bewitched.
Hereafter, she is only my sister in name. Not because I disown her, but because she has disowned me.
And who will tell the mistress of this turn of events?
No one. Since Isabella is no longer a member of her family, she needn't be troubled by news of her.
Yes, sir.
No, you're deceiving me!
Shush, mistress. I promised the master that I would not tell you. I thought it might help you to accept your new life if you knew what Heathcliff...
I knew what? That Heathcliff betrayed me, that he's put a knife through my heart!
Give over that talk, it.
Stop
now, Miss Cathy, mistress.
In the old house. And that wind rattling against the lattice. Do let me feel it. It comes straight down the moor. Let me have one breath. When will Heathcliff return?
I do not know. If he felt anything for you, he would never return and let you be. Now try and put him out of your mind.
I cannot, Nelly. I cannot. You will not let me. Going?
Although it may not appear to be the case, I have tried over these past 4 months to make myself love you. But I cannot.
What is preventing such a thing from happening?
I think you know.
Nevertheless, I would like to hear you say her name.
Your eyes detestably resemble your brother's. dove's eyes, an angel's eyes. So I cannot bear to look at them without wishing you ill.
I abandoned my elegancies, my comforts, and my friends of my former home to marry you.
You married me under delusion.
Then you shall let me go home to the Grange, sir.
You shall go home, but not to the Grange. The Heights will be your home, and you will not be disgracing me by rambling abroad. I cannot allow that.
Surely in your heart you feel some pity.
I have no pity. I have no pity.
Damn you.
Is he come back then? I thought he had gone for good.
We came just now, but he left me, and as I don't know where he is...
Be sure to lock your door. I cannot resist going up there with this every night, trying his door. If once I find it open, he is done for.
Mrs. Linton has not been well. She will never be like she was, but her life is spared. And if you really have a regard for her, then you'll shun crossing her way again.
I must exact from you a promise that you will get me an interview with her.
I say you must not. And you never shall through my means. She's too weak.
Consent or refuse, I will see her. You know as well as I do, for every thought she spends on Edgar, she spends 1,000 on me. And if I thought it were otherwise, 2 words would comprehend my future: death and hell.
Do not persist in this, sir, or I shall be obliged to inform my master, and he shall take measures to secure his house.
Who did you see today, Nelly?
No one in particular. Joseph at church, of course, out praying the bishop as usual.
You're lying to me, aren't you?
You have too much imagination and I have too little. Can it make sense of you some days?
I know that he's back. I can feel him closer. There's no use in trying to deceive me. Why am I so changed?
Well, you eat so little and you will not drink and you've made yourself weak.
I wish I were outdoors. I wish I were a girl again. Half savage, hardy and free.
Oh. You're a young woman. You're going to bring a new young life into the world. You're blessed, if only you could see it.
Open the window wide again. Open it.
I will not give you a death of cold.
I'm not helpless yet. I do it myself.
Yes. Yes, you're home, we're home. We will wander these moors for all eternity.
I thought you'd forgotten me.
You know I could as soon as forget you as my own existence.
What of it, Edgar? And
there's no Edgar. There's no Hindley. It's just you and I. It's just you and I.
Grip on her lungs. She has neither the constitution nor, it seems, the will to recover.
Hell, is that all you can say? Is there nothing you can do?
It'd be a miracle if I can keep her alive till she's gone full term. I believe if the child is not born tonight, then neither will survive.
Dear sweet Edgar, why could you not love someone worthy of your affection and gentleness?
You know, our child will be loved and cherished, do you not?
We're not too tame.
Our child shall wander the moors and be free. as any child must, with your blood running through their veins.
When I was a child, my father went on a trip, and he asked me and my sister what presents we would like. I chose a fiddle, and my sister, already a good rider, asked for a new whip. But when he returned, he did not bring us what we had asked for. He had brought you instead.
Kathy is dying.
And you grew and grew like a big fat cuckoo. And now look at you sitting there as if you are already master of the house.
Your sister is dying. Kathy is dying.
You do not fool me, Heathcliff. You wear your finer feelings like you wear those gentlemen's clothes. Badly. You are nothing more than a gypsy bastard. And so your love for Kathy can only be a pretend love, and your grief for her a pretense.
Don't you say her name. Don't you say her name.
Don't you say her name. Don't you say her name.
Don't you say her name. You will kill him.
You'll hang for it.
I would die a thousand deaths if I knew she were waiting for me.
I am leaving now. I think it fair that you let me leave unmolested.
Go on, go on.
After all, it is better to be hated by you than loved by you. I see that now. So I think I owe you a queer sort of gratitude that you spared me your love and its murderous effect.
Be gone! Go be gone!
See Kathy, I must fight my way in.
She is weak. She's dying.
And you know she would wish to see me. Obey her dying wishes, even if you no longer take heed of mine.
Again. I beg your forgiveness.
Forgiveness? I have nothing to forgive you.
Then you are not angry?
I am not angry. I am sorry to have lost you, especially as I can never think you will be happy.
I'm carrying his child, Edgar. And I have nowhere and nothing. Please, how can I make amends?
If you should really wish to oblige me, then return to the villain you married and persuade him to leave the country.
Do not close your heart to me. Do not close your heart!
The servants are returning from church. My master will not be far behind.
I cannot go.
Oh, for heaven's sakes, just go for 1 hour. I will come to you when the master leaves the house, please.
I promised her. This will be the last time. She begged me to stay.
What in God's name?
Le soir, fiend. You will take her. You will take her and you will comfort her. I shall not refuse to go out of doors. But I will stay in the garden. And mind you, keep to your word, Nelly.
I shall be under the large trees.
Nelly, send for Dr. Kenneth now. Send for him, woman! Thank God. Please, come quickly, please. Please, hurry.
Let me through her.
The breathing is shallow. I fear for our baby.
She's dead. I didn't have to wait for you to learn that. Stop snivelling before me. Damn you all, she wants none of your tears.
Yes, she's dead. Gone to heaven, I hope.
Oh, did she die like a saint?
You poor wretch. Your pride cannot blind God.
How did she die?
She lay with a sweet smile on her face and her baby at her breast.
Well, this bastard lived then.
Kathy's life closed in a gentle dream. May she wake as kindly in the other world.
May she wake in torment. I pray one prayer I repeated and my tongue stiffens. Kathy Earnshaw, may you not rest. Not while I'm living.
You said I'd kill you. Haunt me then. Be with me always. Take any form and drive me mad, but don't leave me. The abyss where I cannot find you. I cannot live without my life.
cannot live without my soul.
Being married will not be such a bad thing, will it, Catherine?
I'm going to see my father.
Miss Lockyer was your mother's.
I hope you'll be a dutiful daughter.
I defy you to frighten me.
Have you heard how your wife speaks to Ingleton? If you cannot take her in hand, perhaps I'll have to do so myself.
Linton loves me, and for that reason I love him. Mr. Heathcliff, you have nobody to love you. And however miserable you make us, we shall still have the revenge of thinking that your cruelty rises from your greater misery. Said that we shall live here, Linton and I together, and we will fill the house with children and happiness.
Then I can go to her. I have been very happy with my little Catherine.
Oh, I see. Playing the loyal servant to the last, are we? Make haste to get my daughter's things together. Don't oblige me to compel you.
Why not let Catherine continue here? Send Master Linton to her.
I'm seeking another tenant for the Grange. Aren't my children about me, to be sure?
Oh. You are on my property. Stand to one side. Yes, I'll have the constable on you.
This is green. My solicitor will give each of you a notice to quit.
Down there.
It's cold up here. Perhaps you should come down and sit by the fire for a few moments. Just while Linton sleeps.
I'll stay up here.
I brought your book. Nelly said you might like it. Thought you might be in need of distraction.
Catherine, come and sit by the fire, my love. Just while Linton sleeps. We'll listen out for him, won't we, Hareton? Thank you.
Lapwing, bonny bird, wheels of your head on moor when it's trying to get to its nest.
I've been to my solicitor. Linton has bequeathed me all of his estate. When he dies, you will be destitute. We'll have no need for books.
If I'm as poor as you say, then I have every need of books to help me escape my miserable fate. What a hideous tyrant. And you, sitting there like a dumb ox while he abuses me.
What was I supposed to have done?
What was I supposed to have done? Stand up to the fiend.
How would you like it if I abused your father?
He's not your father. Hindley was your father, and Heathcliff ruined him and drove him to an early grave.
Heathcliff showed me more love than my father.
Yes, so that he could trick you out of your rightful inheritance.
Don't speak of Heathcliff like that. I'd rather you would abuse me.
Very well. I thought your dumb state was down to your upbringing. But now I see it's the state you prefer, much like a dog or a cart horse. And if ever needed proof, it is your cowardice in not standing to that man.
You're a damned liar. Why have I made him angry by taking your part then? 100 times. I shall have nothing to do with you and your mucky pride and your damned mocking tricks. I shall go to hell, body and soul, before I look sideways at you again.
Is that true? What Hareton said about taking my part?
He's taken beatings for you, that is true.
Why does he insist on defending Heathcliff?
Because he is attached to him by ties stronger than reason can break. And it's cruel of you to try and loosen them.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven.
I'm sorry.
I am sorry. The things I said to you, I did not mean it. I was miserable and bitter at everybody, and I would like you to forgive me.
Catherine, not you?
She was upstairs.
Picked some flowers from over at Grange.
Oh, did you?
It seemed a shame to waste them. They were last at summer. If he finds you in here, he will punish you.
He can't hurt me. I think even he knows that.
I thought we could be friends. Even though you'll be ashamed of me.
I will not be. I think I would like a friend. It's one of my mother's exercise books.
how she loved Heathcliff.
What are you two doing in here?
I wanted to feel close to what is left of my family. I'm the only person to blame. Hareton stayed with me at my insistence.
And who the devil gave you leave to set one foot in here? And who ordered you to obey her?
You shouldn't grudge me one room when you have taken everything from me.
You insolent slut. You never had anything.
If you strike me, Hareton will strike you.
And if Hareton doesn't turn you out of this room, I will strike him back to hell. Hareton, take her. Take her and leave me. All of you, leave me now. Learn to avoid putting me in a passion.
You once told me love would only bring me grief and pain and suffering.
I've seen nothing in my life to change that opinion, otherwise.
You misled me. Not purposely, I don't suppose, but you were wrong.
That is true. Then my whole life's endeavors have been wrong, too. Is that what you would have me believe?
I would have you believe whatever brings you peace.
Would that not be a poor conclusion? An absurd termination to my violent exertions? I feel for you in such a variety of ways. In the first place, your startling likeness to Kathy fearfully connected you with her, but then what is not connected with her to me? What does not recall her? The entire world is a dreadful collection of memoranda that she did exist and that I have lost her.
And you have no feeling of illness, have you?
No. I hope not. I never felt stronger.
I think first you should kiss me for minding so well.
5 kisses if you read it through with no further blunders.
To see behind-the-scenes features, download teacher guides, and watch the program online, visit Masterpiece at pbs.org. To order this program on DVD or the original novel, visit shoppbs.org or call us at 1-800-PLAY-PBS.